Well, here's an awkward camera angle, but we're going to be talking about the 80-meter loop behind me. I put it up. Excuse me, I got my splaining glasses on. That feels a little more natural. So we're going to do a little talking about how I put this up, how I measured it out, and how it works for me. All right, let's do a little video overview of my 80 meter loop, which you may have heard me talk about. You see it up here on my tower. I made a little standoff and brought it out a little bit. I used no pulleys in this system. That was just one more thing to get, and I didn't feel like it was necessary, as I used the 550 paracord. And that stuff slides real easy through those just little eye bolts there. No problem lowering it, going up and down. So you see here, it's on the standoff. That's the MFJ 913 4-to-1 balun. Got it up there running with some Mini 8 coax that I had laying around. 80 meter loop is working pretty good so far. I wanted to do some filming. A good video on putting this together and installing it, but it become a little bit more involved in work. I decided just to do it. If I was taking breaks to video and explain stuff, I was afraid I would just get maybe a little discouraged and not do it. But we got the we'll follow the rope down to the base of the tower. And I found out of my junk pile, I found some counterweights to keep the tension on the rope, but still allow, as the wire and trees may move, let that go up and down. We'll take us a little walk out here. You see some branches I cut out of a tree. See my ladder. Just a few branches I needed to cut to clear the wire and the rope and to get my ladder up in there. We just got this, this is just tied off right now to this thing here. The wire runs up to another eye bolt, which runs out to where the wire goes into the insulator. Keep it from getting a sharp bend in it or anything like that. And it's really difficult to follow this wire when it's got a backdrop of trees and foliage behind it. This is a blue 14 gauge stranded wire that I got on sale at a liquidation store. And it runs out here to another tree. And these bigger trees I gotta have cut one day. But until then, I just got it intermingled to another tree. You can see there's a, barely can see, there's an eye bolt there, another insulator. That ended up being really short on the rope. Way I had to pull it, but it kind of comes through here under that branch. You see why I gotta have them trees cut, they're dying. But let's find this, there's the wire. And it comes and goes over that branch and under that branch on out to that tree. I'll show you on this opposite leg of the tower. You see there's the tower back there. So there's a counterweight at the tower. And I put one more counterweight here at this tree, which is another piece out of the junk pile. And that'll give it the ability to move up and down as the wind blows the trees and such around. Not a whole lot to it. This is approximately 266 feet of wire. I should tell you how I measured this. I took this and I pulled up Google Earth on the interwebs or on the computer, and it has a measuring tool. So you see I put another eyelet bolt there, got the 550 cord running up to it, and it is tied off to a birdhouse. Oh, I'm sorry, that's not a birdhouse, that's my squirrel feeder. And it stretches out, get out of that sun. There's another insulator where the rope and the wire connect. And then it runs back out to the tower. So there's my overview of the 80 meter loop. I'm sorry that I did not take you along the adventure of cutting the tree limbs and climbing the ladders and climbing the towers. I really wanted to do that, but it didn't work out this time. And I definitely am not going back to over to redo it. But that's what we got. 4-to-1 baling, 266 feet approximately of wire.
All right, so let's bring you into the chat real quick, show you some differences switching between the 80 meter loop and the Gap Titan DX Vertical. This just show you some of the noise and the level comparisons. So I'm going to switch screens here and we'll get to that. All right, so take a break here. There's been some discussion about my 80 meter loop only being 20, 25 feet off the ground. Maybe not even that at some points because, of course, my ground's not even. It's got some slopes in it. So some legs may be a little closer to the ground than others. I realize this. When I first put the antenna up, it was purely expectation of, let's see how it works and does it need to be tuned, anything like that. Come to find out, I'm satisfied with it right now with the way it's working. I'm going to put a graphic up. This graphic shows the contacts I've made on voice and FT8. The two Japan stations was FT8, and the Europe stations over there was voice. So you see it's radiating evidently pretty fairly, okay? Everybody's situation is a little different. Some people's situation is a lot different. The ideal height, rule of thumb, I guess, is a quarter wavelength of height for a horizontal HF antenna of the lowest band you plan to operate. Evidently, of course, at 20, 25 feet, I don't have that. So it does probably make, as you can see in the graphic, I have a lot of stateside contacts in the last few days. So it probably does give it some NVIS characteristics, but it's still getting out there. I'm still making contacts and I'm still having fun with it. That's the thing about HF. You can use antenna modeling programs. You can ask a question and get 103,000 different answers and opinions. What everybody doesn't know is how that antenna will perform in your situation where your soil conductivity is different than somebody else's. My ground is mostly clay. You know, sand clay is about what you get here. A little bit of topsoil, but the majority of my yard is clay. And what kind of effect does that have? I don't know. I ain't got a clue. I don't get scientific with this stuff. I just like to have fun. And I like to try it. I'll throw an antenna up, make some. I took an old extension cord and just twisted the three pairs of wires together, cut it as a dipole, strung it up. It didn't work worth the crap, but I had fun trying. Either way, moral of the story is, just do what you can do with what you can do it with. And try it. Just try it. Have fun and enjoy it. It may work great for you where it don't work worth the darn for the majority of the others. And it may be right backwards. What works great on the internet may not work worth a darn for you. Just try it. See what you can do. Experiment. That is ham radio. Have fun. I'm going to give you a little audio on the radio. Now you ought to be able to hear that. We'll start out at 10 meters. That's what it happens to be on right now. I'm currently on the vertical. So I'm going to have to roll back and switch the antennas. And you will be able to see when I switch to the 80 meter loop. See that noise came on up. S9 just a little over on the loop. Go to the vertical, the noise floor goes down.
Okay, well,
and so does his signal. His signal is maxing out about a S8, S7 now. And we'll go back to the loop.
Here in Barcelona, Spain. Send the long pass.
I think the loop's doing its job for sure.
London.
Now, you know, fool me once, you know, thing. So, hey, that's good. You got a chuckle out of it. Well, I got a chuckle last week, you know. It just didn't dawn on me until you told me to look at it. So, anything else for the net, John?
So there's your little overview of what it looks like and sounds like on the radio. The noise level does come up, but like someone explained, more antenna, more signals, more noise. So yes, it does bring the noise up, but it brings the signals up as well. All right, out of here. Have a good one.